spicy hello to you. This is Diana Price, and welcome to Spicy Business Talk Radio, where we bring you the ingredients for business success. Yes, we're here every Tuesday at 12 noon Pacific time on rmconair.com. So I want you to follow us on Facebook. If you have not already joined our Facebook team, in terms of following us, liking us on Facebook, we do a lot of posting about business success and about things that really are valuable for your personal life and for your business life. So I want you to go to my Facebook page. That is facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. Again, facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. And my other Facebook page is facebook.com/DianaPriceAssociates. Diana Price Associates. And of course, if you just want to friend me and just hang out with me on my regular page, that's Diana Price. But we really want you to get involved in our community because we have a lot of amazing things, a lot of evidence-based research that will help you build your business, grow your business, start a business, and just really be a better business person, a better person as well. It's really important. If you want to follow us on our YouTube channel, it's youtube.com/spicybusinesstalk. So you've got all our digits, so make sure that you are following us. And today we're bringing you more of that culture, more of that being that's inside your business, but it has to start with you. So if you didn't read our post today, I want you to know that you can go over to dpriceassociates.com. If you want to call in today, the digits are 323-965-1600. That's 323-965-1600. Call in and talk to me. Ask me any questions about what you need questions answered. A lot of people are asking, why and how can I improve my service culture? And that's one of my corporate clients asked me. He said, you know, we've got some really good employees. We have some people that are very skilled at what they do. But it seems like everything is not meshing together. So, of course, you know, the one of the things that I tell them is, what is your culture like? What do they think about, you know, how they what their business, what your business is, and how they work, and how they fit into your business? That's an important part of your culture. So go to our blog, Why Your Culture Controls Your Business Success, at dpriceassociates.com. Your culture controls your success. And I'm going to tell you a whole lot about culture today because it is something that once you are part of a culture, it's a ritual. You have to keep it going. You have to maintain that culture and maintain everybody in that's positioned in the culture. So the service culture, it has to nurture your team members. So, you know, my corporate client was saying, you know, I've got these great people that really know what they're doing, that are very skilled. But if you don't have a culture that supports them, but of course the culture has to support your business first, and it has to celebrate what they do, because they can be so good at what they do. But if they come into a culture that is non-existent, then everybody makes things up as they go along. And guess what that means? Complete and utter chaos. So the best quality people are definitely who you want in your seats. But all the money, all the time you spend getting the right people in the right seats is eventually going to really bring them down to what I call mediocre, average, and on the C team. They all of a sudden become C team employees if you do not have a formal culture in place. So let me define culture for you. I have several definitions of culture because I was firsthand involved in not only creating a culture, nurturing a culture, but making it work. And it's not a one-time affair. It's not a two-time affair. It's an ongoing training workshop. It really is something that you have to spend a lot of time with. So let's define culture. Let's define what a service culture is. Well, before we define a service culture, I want you to think about a group of people that are in the same race, that have the same religion, a family members that do similar things and that have similar features. So think about that as a nucleus as I define culture for you, okay? Number one, culture is a shared value system of beliefs and attitudes that influences and characterizes you and your business. So whatever that you have in your system that you believe, your attitudes, it's going to be the perception of your business and you. So again, culture is a shared value system of beliefs and attitudes that influences and characterizes the perception of you and your business. That is crucial. That's the A number one. So when people come to work every day, if they don't know what your culture is, if they don't understand that the first thing that they have to do when they greet your customers is smile and use their name, all of these are ancillary things because it has to be in writing. It has to be a formalized approach. And I'll get to some of the specifics later. Number two, a culture is the way things get done in your workplace. As I said earlier, if you have the greatest people, skilled people, and they come to work every day, and you know, when you first hired them, they were like, oh my God, they are just so amazing. And all of a sudden, things just start slacking down. They're starting slacking, they get comfortable with you, and their work starts to be mediocre in terms of, well, they missed this little thing and they hadn't been missing that before. So this really lends itself to people just making up their own rules and just going along with whatever the right thing is to do that particular day. However it feels, that's what I do. That's going to get you in trouble. And if they don't understand how things get done in the workplace, they're going to make them up themselves. That's number two. Number three, how do your people describe where they work? If I came to your place of business and I said to your employees, tell me where you work. Tell me about this place that you work in. Tell me a little bit about it. How would they describe that? Would I get the same description from all of the employees? Would I get 10 different descriptions from 10 different employees? That is where the nucleus is. So how your people describe where they work and how they understand your business and see themselves as a part of your business. How do they see themselves as a part of your team? If they see themselves as, well, you know, I do all the work and this one sits over there and you have to beg them to do something, and then they want to take long lunches and they come back from lunch and they act like they're doing something so they don't have to help. Those are all things that really influence the perception of how people relate to each other. So, you know, you have to really take these things very, very, very seriously. Number four, a culture, and this is so important. A culture is an unwritten law of behavior. An unwritten law of behavior. So if you have nothing in writing, how people do things every single day, it's accepted and it's recognized as how it's supposed to be. So it's an unwritten law. It's an unwritten law of behavior. So how your people behave, how they start behaving, then how they end up behaving is a part of what we call culture. Just think about how you behave around your family, family functions, how you see, you know, a race of people, how they behave. So think about all of those features. That is the unwritten law, which is called culture. And that culture is definitely something that you have to get a firm handle on. And because otherwise, everything is going to be accepted. People are going to make things up as they go along. And guess what? You're going to have a chaotic business and your results are going to just, I don't want to say go down the you know what, but that's probably where they're going to end up. Okay, number five, a culture can marshal subjective opinions of you and your business. So the way you allow things to be, the way you allow things to be in your business, however you decide what to do or what not to do, it will marshal very subjective opinions of you and your business. So understand these five definitions. These are Diana's definitions. These are Diana Price and Associates definitions because I've lived through culture. I've worked culture. I've created culture. I've had to manage culture. And you know, when people are in a really good environment, when they're in a really good culture, when they enjoy the atmosphere, when they joy that they're celebrated, when they can do the things that they see top management really celebrating them, they're going to celebrate your customers in the same way. I hope you get that, because you can't just not think that your employees are your customers. Your employees are your number one customers. How you treat them is how they're going to treat your customers. So I want to just review why we're talking about service culture. The service culture that you have or you don't have is going to control your business. It's going to control all the ingredients that you have that either is going to make your business or it's going to break your business. So the best quality people that you have, that you go out and you pay good money for, that you have with these great interview questions and you go through the process of elimination, you rate your candidates. I mean, those are all really good things to get the right people in the right seat. But if you bring them into a culture that's chaotic and is subjective and it's unwritten and there's no process, then expect for it to break down, and all of a sudden those A-team employees are going to be C-team employees, not caring, and you're going to have a big mess on your hand. So when we come back from our break, we are going to talk more about why culture controls your business success. You're listening to Diana Price, and you're listening to Spicy Business Talk Radio. We'll be right back. Host of Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. We're here every Tuesday at 12 noon on rmconlive.com. That's Pacific Standard Time. Do you have any challenges that you need to unwrap? Any leadership challenges? Anything that is confronting your comfort zone? Because when you tackle your comfort zone, when you change your language, you're going to be a lot more successful with your sales. You'll have better interactions with your customers. Your employees, everything around you will start getting better results. And that's what we do here. We welcome the who's who of the seat on Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. Speakers, entrepreneurs, authors, and thought leaders. So we want you to join us and call us for a strategy session, a free strategy session, so we can figure out what your sizzle assessment is and if you are becoming the influential leader and business professional that you need to become. Email us at diana@dianapressassociates.com, and we'll see you next week on the show every Tuesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time. See you on the other side. Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price. Thanks for joining us today. As I said, we're here every Tuesday at 12 noon on rmconair.com, where you can get a handful of good ingredients for business success. So make sure you join us. And if you ever need to call me, just ask a question about your culture. And if you are just struggling with just something that's going on in your business that relates to your employees, your leadership challenges, your customers, that's what we specialize in. That's what I've spent 20 years of my life, both in corporate, well, actually more than 20 years in corporate America, you know, and now with my own business. So, you know, I definitely have the answers or know where to get those answers for you, because I've lived it. I've lived through the mistakes, the failures, and now we've got the ingredients for the successful So I want to welcome you back to the show. And if you need to reach me, 866-631-7500. Once again, 866-631-7500. And then you can always email us at info@dianapriceassociates.com. info@dianapriceassociates.com. Okay, let's get back to service culture and why you need this. So we talked about the five main definitions of a service culture. So yeah, I think you have those. We're not going to review those until the end of the show. So if you missed it, tune in and we'll review that again for you. But why does your service culture matter? You know it matters because you don't have one. I told you about all the subjective rules, but your business culture has a profound influence on the quality and the results of your team's work. So if you don't have that culture in place, your team, as I said before, the results are going to be your fault because you have not put a process together that says, this is what I expect, and this is what I expect, and this is what I don't expect. Okay? So it's so important how they engage with each other, how they engage with your customers. That service culture dictates all of that. It dictates how they engage with you. It dictates the amount of issues that you, as managers and leaders, are going to have with your employees. You're going to have issues and more issues and things that are just that come up that shouldn't come up because you haven't taken the time to put together a culture. And not only put it together, you can't see, it's not enough to say, here's my culture. My culture says, blah, 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 whatever you say. But it has to be a part of their being. How do you make it a part of their being? Why does it matter to them? Okay, that's the important part. So that's how we can help you get your customer, get your culture together and strategize with your employees and your customers and your leaders and the whole thing. So let's continue. You and your team interact, right? Either face to face or on the phone. So when you do that, you both have the opportunity to make decisions, spur of the moment decisions, like just like that. Okay? If you don't have a baseline to make your decisions, if you're just running off half cocked, just doing whatever, whenever, the decisions are going to the way that you make the decisions are really going to show. So it's really important that when you make those spur of the moment decisions. Sometimes they're small, they're important decisions. You do them every single day. But frequently, no one is around to watch over your employee's shoulder. So that's one of the reasons it matters so much that they understand how far they can go. How can they cross the line? What can they do for your customers? What can they do that they're comfortable with? What can they say? What kind of talk track have you given them? What kind of environment are they working in? So it matters when they're on the phone, what they say, because you know as well as I do. You know, you go into a business, the first person you see is the receptionist. A lot of times what happens, the receptionist is the person that is the newest person on the job. They maybe know not a lot about your business, hardly anything at all. So they're representing you. They're representing you. What they say has a real effect and impact on your image. So consider putting your best people in that position, because then they will be able to not only understand the nuances and the customers and what to say and how to say it, then your receptionist can actually learn, the new person can actually learn from that. So it's really important that a thriving culture provide an infrastructure. And this is what I'm getting to you today, an infrastructure of how to really get it done. So let's talk about how your culture is going to navigate your decisions. Your decisions, what your people say to your customers, it's not going to change if you don't change it. People can be very, very, very curt. They don't think they are. You know, if the talk track is really, really something that you have not given them, you have to give them a talk track. It's okay to say, you make that your own, but you have to give them guidelines and a process and a structure of what to say. Because this culture that I'm talking about is going to guide, it's going to form the guidelines, it's going to form the standards, it's going to form the expectations, and it's going to provide the motivation for your employees to excel and to operate in their best interest and in your best interest. They're going to be a lot more motivated. They're going to bring a lot more customers to your team, and you're going to be really a lot happier when you have this in place. So I have a lot of notes that I want to share with you today. I don't want to miss anything because this is just way too important. So I want to go through a couple things that will help you improve your culture. Okay. Now, in order to improve your culture, you have to first have one. So if you don't have one, you got to start somewhere. So if you want superior employees, if you want superior results, start first. Get a culture. Put it in writing. If you need me to help you with an infrastructure as how to start, you just give me a call. So the lesson here is when you improve your culture, it's going to have a dramatic effect on the way you improve your profitability, your bottom line, your employee engagement, your customer experience. It's just going to maximize the value of your business. It's going to be priceless to have a culture like I'm talking about. So there's a lot of ways that I want to share with you how you can create a better culture. I've made some notes and I'm going to share those notes with you. And I've learned in the past, not only from the corporation that I work with, the businesses that I've coached and consulted, but I've learned that cultures are very different. So you have to be lenient when I say lenient, I don't mean giving way to things that are mediocre. That is not at all what I mean. You have to understand the kind of people that you have working for you, and you have to understand what the mission of your business is. So you have to really understand all of those things when you start your framework for your culture. That's going to make the high performance measures just really excel. So number one, have a mission that you can really stick to. So when you're forming your culture, make sure that you take a look at, why am I doing business? Who are my customers? Who would I like my customers to be? Do I have the right amount of customers? Are my employees my customers too? You gotta make sure that your employees are a part of this mission statement. If you leave them out and think, oh yeah, well, you know, I get employees who work for me, I pay, they get a paycheck, they're supposed to do what I'm telling them to do. It doesn't work like that. It's a brand new day. You have to be delightful to everybody in your sphere. So let's go back to having a mission. Your mission has to be classy, it has to be world class, it has to be something that, you know, if someone sneaks up on you, you're still doing it. You're not doing something else because no one's looking. Okay? That's very important. So it's you have to focus on the common good of your employees, the common good of your company. Well, let me rephrase that. You have to focus on the common good, but your business should come first. The common good of your business is number one. Then the common good. Then you have to decide if I would say your customers and then your employees. However, now the way that plays out, the common good of your business, the common good of your customers, and the common good of your employees, if you have the right leadership strategies in place, it's all going to play out to the best, because the leaders, all of you, are going to make sure your employees have a real good sense of how they interact with this whole system, and you're gonna celebrate them. You're gonna have a motivational environment, so your employees are not gonna think they're at the bottom of the totem pole, because they are not. They can be on the same par with your customers in many cases, because as you know, how they treat your customers is how your results go. So you have to communicate that philosophy, your mission, and your purpose, because it has to go often beyond. Way beyond your bottom line. So let me continue. The first thing is, almost time to take a break, but we don't want to take a break right now. So the first thing is to make sure you have a mission statement, and a mission statement that is firm and everybody understands it. So let me give you an example of some things that you can think about. How do you delight your customers? That could be a part of your mission statement. How do you keep your customers loyal? That can be a part of your mission statement. How do you make your customers feel fabulous? How do you make your employees feel fabulous? Now, all of these things are things that you have to think about, and how you write it up, and that's very important. So the first step is create your mission statement and think about your customers, the loyalty, your employees, how they're going to be engaging in that situation. Okay, so we talked about your mission statement. Now it's important to put together a system where it's reflected, your mission is reflected in everything that you do and everything your employees do. So if they come to work and they're working for, you know, if they're talking face to face to your clients, their actions, their attitudes, all the things that they do have to be reflected in how they talk to your customers. Now, they can't reflect that if you don't reflect that. So the next step that you want to do is to make sure that you, management team, from CEO on down, that you are living and breathing the same actions and attitudes to your employees, that your employees, that you expect your employees to live and breathe to your customers. That is huge. You can't have a driver of a culture unless the leadership is so involved in it. If your leaders aren't involved, you may as well just close the door, hang up a sign, say, we'll be back when we get it right. Because if you don't have it right, it's not going to be right. Okay, so I hope you get that. So you've got to get a mission together, and you have to make sure the leaders' action, the employees, that everybody has actions and attitudes that reflect on the customers. All right. So hugely important mission statement. Number two, communicate the heck out of that mission statement. Communicate the heck. And I don't mean posters in the lunchroom, communicate it every single day. Yeah, I'm not making fun of posters in the lunchroom and things on the computers to remind folks. No, you do that because that is very, very important. But if you do that only, if you only do that, then you are making huge mistakes with your culture. When you communicate to your people, you have to define it. You have to define how they fit into your organization. You have to define why it's important that they fit in this way to your organization. Because, well, now I got to take a break, but I just want to give you this last thought, that when you communicate and enforce the rules of the game in your culture, it'll make a huge difference. We're going to talk a little bit more about rule number two about your culture, and we'll be right back. This is Diana, and you're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. Thanks for being with us. We'll be right back.
Hi, my name is Catherine Arnold. I am an entertainment expert and consultant, and I just finished my interview with Diana Price of Spicy Business Talk with Diana, which was fantastic. And my experience with Diana was great. And I think one of the best things about it is Diana is very fluid. And she's very positive. And she really inspired me to be very comfortable here in the studio. As you can see, it's not only radio, but we're on camera. And I had a great time. And the conversation went from business experience to personal growth experience, because as we were talking about, personal growth is so important as a business person, especially as an entrepreneur. And Diana's breadth of knowledge about the entertainment industry and about being an expert witness was evident. She'd done her homework and she had done her research, and her crew here was fantastic. And overall, I had a really great time. And if you want to check out more about what Diana does, I think you should check out her show and also go to her website, because she is just phenomenal. We've become fast friends, and I look forward to coming back and doing another show on Spicy Talk Radio. And again, my name is Catherine Arnold. I am an award-winning producer and director, and my website is theentertainmentexpert.com.
Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price, and you're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. We love what we do here. I think I told you how much I love what I do. It's just a pleasure to, you know, do what you want now. It's awesome. And one of the things I really love is serving. You know that I'm a servant I'm a complete servant of my customers, my clients, and that's how we all should be. We all should be giving and serving. So we're talking about the ingredients of a business culture and why culture drives your business success. It is so, your business success is so driven by your culture, and it's driven by you, and you should be the culture of your business, and you should make it a point to communicate it. And that's item number two that we're talking about. Communicate and enforce the rules of your game, because if your culture, as I told you, one of my clients said, how can I improve my culture? So if your culture is not what you want, you know, think about what rules you have in place now. Maybe the rules that you have in place are not appropriate. Maybe they're not adequate. Maybe you haven't communicated them. Maybe you just haven't really told people what it's all about. So that way you're not enforcing it. And if you're not enforcing it, they're going to go by the wayside. If you allow someone to get away with something and you don't deal with it in the structure of your business culture, then one thing will lead to another, and one thing will lead to another, and pretty soon it'll just completely be out of whack. So for any business to function properly, everyone on your team, including you, have to know these things, and you have to enforce these things. And let me give you some things that you always want to follow when you communicate. I've told you this before. When you communicate what's acceptable, okay? What is acceptable? Number two, you communicate, well, what's not acceptable. What's acceptable and what's not acceptable? Huge. Because someone could say, well, you didn't tell me that. I couldn't do that. So what's acceptable and what's not acceptable? And then number three, you want to communicate what you expect. What are your expectations? What is expected of everyone? That is huge. And number four, how you expect them to interact with each other. Okay? Do you expect them to interact with each other during business hours and talking with each other if there's no work to do? If there's no work to do, why isn't there no work to do? That's a leadership issue right there. And if customers are around, are they talking to each other? You have to let them know how they are expected to interact with each other. Then you have to let them know how you will hold them accountable. Okay? And then you have to hold yourself accountable too. Yeah, you have to hold yourself accountable. Now, these are really basics, but they're really essential. They're guidelines to establishing the rules of your culture that everyone has to abide by. Okay, so make sure that your team is on board with this. Make sure that your managers are on board with this, okay? So let's move on. You know, as a leader, you're going to do the best you can. You have to stay focused. You can't let your guard down, because then the expectations, the standards, your guidelines, the impact, it's all going to be affected. So everyone comes to work, you know, you expect them to be on top of their game. So if they're not on top of their game, they're not accomplishing your mission. And the tasks that everyone perform, if everyone has a specific thing to do and they know what to do, then you're good. Then they now need to know those four things that I just told you. What do you expect them to do? What do you expect them not to do? What is acceptable? What is not acceptable? Yeah, all of these things make up your culture, believe it or not. So if you see someone slack it off a little bit, it's not your job to go and create a ruckus. That's not what I'm saying. You don't create a ruckus when you see things going wrong. First of all, you ask yourself, do I have the right culture in place? Have I been enforcing it? Do they understand what they're supposed to do? And then you gently celebrate it when they are doing the right thing. You celebrate that. And when they have maybe just fallen off course a little bit, explain to them just ask them, how do you understand what you're supposed to do? Work with them, because you're not there to go da 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 da. No, that's not what I'm saying. You can't do that. Okay. So do the best you can and make sure that you are doing the right thing by your employees. You want your employees to respect respect you at all costs. So do the right thing by your employees, because they'll do the right thing by your customers. And when you do the right thing, that may mean that you have to take people to task, but there's a wonderful way to do that. You want them to be dependable and you want them to be accountable. So when I say do the right thing, it's important that you have a process where they're accountable. Okay. So I think I changed my camera. So if you need some feedback or some coaching on how to really approach people that are really, sometimes you have problem employees that are just really, really difficult to manage. And I get that, because 20 years I've done that. Yeah, I can tell you stories about problem employees, and it's not easy. It's not easy. And if you don't have problem employees, if you just have managers or people like that that you manage, you know, it can be the same thing. So I really get that. So, but important to, when you do the right thing, if you see a problem, don't ignore the problem. Own the problem. Go after it, solve it. Don't let the sun shine and go down at the end of the day and you still haven't taken care of that problem, okay? Fix it, fix it, fix it. You tell me I have to take a break. I got to take a break, so I will be right back. This is Diana Price, and you are listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Caller, what happened?
Got to tell you about a very good friend of mine, Diana Price. I met Diana a few years ago at a couple of events. We've seen each other now on and off throughout the last couple of years, and I've got to tell you what a fantastic individual she is and what a dynamic coach. She's an incredible speaker. Her presence lights up the room as she walks in, so you have got to make time in your schedule right now to contact Diana and make sure you hire her to be your coach or to be a speaker at one of your events.
Hi, welcome back. This is Diana Price, and you're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio every Tuesday, 12 noon, rmconair.com. And we are spicing it up a little bit today. We spice it up a little bit every week, but today it's the ingredients for business success. And, you know, once you get all this, you know, this is a little tedious to get this all together. That's why I'm going through this, because it's, you know, it's a lot of research that I'm bringing you. So I hope you really appreciate the detail and the content that you can use in your business. You can walk right away from here and put this into practice. But, you know, I've gone through the process of bringing you all this detail. When you present it, you're going to have to really present it with force, present it with sizzle, with spice, and, you know, I can help you do that. But let's get back to the details. Let's get back to these. We've been talking about do the best you can when you start the process of communicating your business culture. When I say do the best you can, don't really be a mediocre or a bland person. And I say that all the time. You have to really put yourself into it. Put all you have into everything that you're doing. Make it known that it's all that you're putting all you have in it. Okay, so let's move on. We talked about do the right thing. Don't let people get away with stuff. You know, make sure you solve the problem. Fix it. You know, you're not fixing it in a mean way. You're just doing what you have to do to make your business work. And you're going to show your people that you care. This is the next topic we're talking about. Show your people in your business culture, in your mission statement, show them that you care. Every single day, leaders, you need to be saying, thank you. I really appreciate the great job you're doing. Now, if they're not doing a great job, then you constructively let them know what they can do better. Ask them for their feedback. What's going on here? Last week, you had such great results. This week, It looks like maybe you need some help. What can I help you with? Don't get on your people. Respect them. Always show them that you care. When they are struggling, show them that you care, you're concerned, and you want to help them. Say thank you. Say it's my pleasure. Say I'm sorry. Pardon me. And these are the same things that I'm going to ask you to have your people say to your customers. Thank you. Thank you. It's my pleasure to serve you. I really appreciate you taking the time to come in today. All these things are small, but they are so, so important. So I want you to have expression in your mission statement. I want you to express yourself in a very sizzling, in a very upbeat, in a way that is just everything that you do is not boring, but it's spicy. Understand? So demonstrate that you appreciate often. Demonstrate to your employees that you appreciate often. Demonstrate to your customers that you appreciate them often. Say it. Say it over and over and over again. Are you getting this? Okay. So now here's some basic principles that I want you to really be look at to make sure you forewarn your people about what's going on for the day. When you come in, part of your mission statement of communication. I mean, when you think about communications, it's everything. What's going to be going on from the beginning of the day to the end of the day? Every day, there should be what I call a huddle. I used to have huddles with my team every day. Maybe it would be a minute or 2 minutes. It would be to say, you know, this is what we're expecting to go on today. This is what's new. This is what's happened. You know, so-and-so may be expecting a client coming in. Whatever is going on, or if you're expecting a rush because it's the first of the month, or whatever the situation, you're expecting a lot of phone calls, huddle with your team and try to give them some guidelines to, you know, how to proceed for the day. At that time, take the opportunity to restate your mission. Restate why they're there and just ask them to all just really get ready for showtime. Because showtime is what it is. You know, when the doors open, it is showtime. And those smiles, you know, they can't be fake. You know, that's why this culture has to really be communicated. Really, really important. It's really important. You've never seen a great organization, a great company, a great entrepreneur, you know, anyone in this life has not achieved great success being mediocre. So if you can't put your all into your mission statement, if you can't put your all into your culture and spice it up a little bit, be lenient, you know, have fun with it. You know, just make it yourself. That way you can really get excellence, and you don't have to tolerate mediocrity, because you know, if you tolerate it, that's what you're going to get out of your culture. You're going to get junk. You're going to get crap. And if you tolerate that in your life, it's going to be the same thing. So if you have people in your life that don't respect your excellence, your ability to be excellent, if people in your life think that you're mediocre, then check yourself. Go back and look in the mirror and see what kind of culture you are emitting for yourself. See if you have a culture of the values, if you have the being inside yourself that I'm telling you that you need in your business. Okay, so that leads me to the next one. Raise your standards. Raise your standards. Now, what does your business look like? Last week, if you remember, I talked about the five senses. I talked about the five senses. I'm not going to go over all of them, but when you raise your standards, go around and look to see, what does my business look like? Do I have a good vision? You know, do I have a good culture? What does my business look like from the outside? What does it smell like? What does it feel like? All those things were what I'm talking about, raising your standard. Now, let's get into a little bit of meat of raising your standards. If you have a product, you have a service, if you are a coach, whatever it is that you do, if you're an executive, a CEO, whatever it is that you do, when the effect of what you do is so important. So if it's a product that you're selling, one way to raise the standard is to give more. to give more. If you are a writer, you know, or if you sell products, give something free, give something special. So think about how you can create a lot more customer loyalty by raising your standards. Now, here's some things that may help you. Just some bullet points, and I want to share with you just things that will not only help your financial results, but also help your employee morale, help the motivation, help the whole look and feel, the impact of how you can start a transformation with your service culture. And raising your standards can take a lot of different forms, okay? And so let's talk about how your employees look. How they look, how they dress, how do they come to work? That's part of raising your standards. So if you don't have a dress code, maybe you should. But if you do have a dress code and they're ignoring it, oh my goodness. Oh, look down and see, oh, is that acceptable? So take a look at that dress code. Is the appearance the way it should be? All right, if it's not, that's up to you to deal with. Now, you have to be careful when you deal with dress code. You have to give guidelines, and you know, need help with that, just holler. We'll help you. We'll help you for sure. That's 866-631-7500. So let's move on to, you know, how your employees look. How does your facility look? If I walked across your, you know, your business, is everything clean? Carpet clean? Anything on the floor? If I went over and, you know, looked at, you know, where the employees sit, how does their desk area look? Is it nice and clean? If I went to the restroom, is it spotless? So those are raising standard issues. Make sure that you have done a survey and a spot check. So raise your standards on your products and your services. When you present, if someone says, I need this, you know, I need this package, I need this whatever it is, I need this, you know, this item that you're selling me. You go back and you see that you only have one item left and they need three of those. So what's that say about how you're keeping your inventory? What's that say about your standards? You don't want to be out of stock. You don't want to be like, I don't have this because we forgot to order, or, you know, someone took the last one. I mean, that's a part of raising your standards. When I go out to eat, you know, I love really good food. I mean, someone was asking me what my favorite food is. I love Chilean sea bass. Have you ever had Chilean sea bass? I love Chilean sea bass. It's like one of my favorite. I love that. I'm a fish person anyway. So when I go to a restaurant, think about how a restaurant could raise their standards. Basically the same things I'm talking about. How their employees look, you know, how their whole facility looks. But, you know, when I get my food and it's not hot, I'm not going to be happy. No. I want my Chilean sea bass nice and warm and hot. Well, I want it hot, but I don't want it to burn me, but you know what I mean. I want it the way it's supposed to be. It comes out of the oven. I want it. I don't want it 5 minutes later and it's cold. That's bad. That's not a good standard. I'm going to send it back. I want it warm. I may not send it back. I may eat it, but the point is, you know what I'm saying. Raise your standards. So whatever it is, a minimum standard. So if you're busy, all these restaurant people, they're busy and they've got all these orders and they're all sitting there lined up waiting to go because they're taking orders and whatever it is that they're doing, you know, you got to figure out a way to keep that food warm, don't you? Yeah. Just like you have to figure out a way to get the all of the packages, all the books, all the things that you need to sell, to present to your clients, you have to have those in stock. You can't just not have them in stock. So, okay, another way to raise your standards. You know, I had clients, my team had clients, and I did too, because I work with clients a lot, but some of the clients were just so awesome. They would always, you know, come in and talk with us, and when they got ready to do whatever they do, they would allow us to do that for them. Send a little handwritten thank you note saying, thank you so much for always being our most valued client. Say that to them and make sure it's just a little handwritten note saying, I really appreciate you. Thank you. I mean, these things go way deep in telling someone how you feel about them and really getting repeat business to come back, because you need your customers continually flowing through your pipeline. You really need that, because your employees are your lifeblood. They're your paycheck. If you don't have your customers are your paycheck. Your employees help make your customers be your paycheck, but your customers are definitely your paycheck. So to make sure that you write those little notes saying thank you, you know, from yourself. And the other thing I used to do is I'd send little birthday notes like, happy birthday, thinking of you, hoping you're having a good day, and some fun things to do that are really kind of out of the box. Say you are just going to have a customer appreciation. Do a customer appreciation just for a handful of customers, or just say, hey, what are you doing? You know, we're having a little something at the office. Just want to invite you over. We're having some snacks and refreshments, nothing special. Just wanted you to come by, and, you know, we wanted to say how much we appreciate you. And then that's an opportunity for you to find out if there's any concerns. It is so important to ask in advance about concerns and complaints and things that maybe they haven't told you because, you know, you've had such a great rapport. But maybe there's one teeny little thing that's just bothering them. It's like, oh my God, how could they not know this? So use those little opportunities to ask questions and whatever complaints they have, ask them. Do you have any concerns? What could we do better? All right, that's important. So we're coming to having just another quick short break, because I want to close up with a couple special things. But just know that when you do the right things by your employees, with your mission statement, with your culture, with you really celebrating, embracing them, and when they do the right thing with your customers, saying thank you, my pleasure, sending thank you notes, it's all this is going to have such a positive response. You're going to be so pleased. But it has to all be in place. The leaders have to provide direction and focus and purpose. You're listening to Diana at Diana Spicy Business Talk Radio, and we'll be right back. Stay with us.
Are you a diabetic? Need some energy? Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink is the healthiest, best-tasting energy drink around. For more information and online ordering with free shipping, please visit hiphopbev.com. Remember, Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, suitable for diabetics, great for everyone.
Welcome back. I'm just sitting here going through my stuff, making sure I don't miss anything for you. This is Diana Rice, and welcome to Diana Spicy Business Talk Radio. It's a pleasure to be with you. It's always a pleasure to be with you. I love being with you guys. So we're talking about why your culture drives your business success. And we've been giving you all the ingredients for business success today as it relates to forming a culture. So, you know, I wanted to just ask you what kind of questions that you may have, because I'd like you to spend some time either writing me, emailing me, calling me, because there's a lot of things that are untold and unsaid about culture and your culture and your business. And if you're an entrepreneur, or if you're a small business owner, or if you want to be a small business owner, that's where you start. So you want to start by making a culture that you can live with. So I want you to connect with me on Facebook, and just if you have any questions about culture, I want you to tell me exactly what they are. So again, my Facebook page is facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk. business talk. I want to drive that because I want you to talk to me about what concerns you're having. You know, a friend of mine called me the other day and said, I need you to come in and help me with my people. And I was talking to another peer, and she said, oh my, this is completely different. So at least four or five times, I've been asked about culture and why things don't work and why people get away with different things. So this is a serious thing. It's the beginning of the year. You don't want this to grow and get worse where you're just having to really put out fires. And that's all you're doing all day is putting out fires instead of getting productivity and performance done. Putting out fires is awful. So, you know, if you're struggling with the mistakes and the things that are going on, you know, get some help, and I'll be there to help you. So what can I help you with right now in as it relates to culture? Because what I want to see you do with this culture is to use it to get more sales, to use it really, really, really in a way that you're not selling, but you're showing your people how to interact. And it's not about the transaction. Too many times a culture is like, sell, 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 sell. How much you sell today? How much you sell today? Did you meet your numbers? Yeah, you got to meet your numbers. And the way to meet your numbers is starting with a culture of connection and interaction. So, yeah, you want to get more sales. You have to. And I'll show you how to do that by having it done with a delightful service culture that thrives. Okay. And I want to show you how to get more leads, how to get a lot more leads by using service culture as your baseline. Okay. In addition, if you have your culture together, I'll show you how to tweak it. I'll show you how what things that you have done, and maybe some things that you haven't looked at. And if you're also interested in creating products, if you're an entrepreneur and part of your culture is continuing to offer information products or things that represent you, that impact your bottom line, might be, you know, how to put together the information product. So I have a whole system on that. As a matter of fact, I'm going to invite you to a webinar and I'll show you exactly how to create your own really good selling information products. So let me know what you need and what you have and what I can do to help you. And when you think about it, I want you to think about it strategically. So when you think about the question I'm asking you, how can I help you? I want you to wave a magic wand. I want you to just keep that wand waving. And money is not an option. Nothing is an option. What is it that you would want to see in your business? How would you want to see your business thrive? Wave that magic wand. Just wave it and say, how can I better deliver on the promise that I already have? Wave it. I would love it to look like. And you fill in the blank. Because when you do, when you just really let it out, when you say, this is how I want my business to be, and you go after it, I'm there for you. I'm there right in the trenches, and I'm there running the race right next to you to show you how to do it and how to eliminate all the mistakes and failures so you can just keep moving forward. We really appreciate the time that you've taken to be with us today, so don't take this lightly. I will be happy to sit down with you or to get on a phone call with you. I'll give you at least a 30-minute consultation. So if you need that consultation, give us a call at 866-631-7500. That's 866-631-7500. Excuse me. Don't forget our Facebook page, facebook.com/spicybusinesstalk, and email us at diana@dianaprice.com. And if you need to go and look at some of our other programs, go to our YouTube channel, which is Spicy Business Talk. YouTube channel, Spicy Business Talk. We look forward to really working with you. Go to the blog post today at dpriceassociates.com and put your name and your email address in, and we'll be more than happy to start our communication with you. Thank you so much for being us. You're listening to Diana's Spicy Business Talk Radio. Have a great, wow, have a great week. Whoa. I got it out. Have a great week. We'll see you next Tuesday. Bye.